they're all science fiction. I mean, they have special people, you know, behind it. I get to grow with a cast, like age with a cast, and throughout the years we get to witness each other's lives in different stages, and that's beautiful.
Where's the turnout, Jody? After everything we've talked about, I'm not seeing it. You understand what I'm saying? Use what you have and turn up.
Jesus, she heard you.
Excuse me?
She heard you. We all heard you. You don't have to speak to her like that. Anyone can see she's working her ass off.
That's enough, Miss Rodriguez.
I went in and I read the sides and they liked what I did, and then they asked me to come back and they put me with a ballet teacher in a room and they just, you know, video recorded me doing some moves. And then I met Nicholas Heitner for it. You know, back then, or usually when you audition, you have a first audition with a casting director, then a second one, and then eventually you get to meet the director and the producers. And so once I booked the role of Eva Rodriguez, then it was just about like learning, you know, the choreographies and getting to meet the cast. And that was a wonderful summer. We shot it in the summer of 1999. I know I'm dating myself, but I love it. I turned 21 on that set, and we shot it in Lincoln Center. So obviously in the city of my dreams, which I, being a New Yorker, I just love it. And we got to shoot it in Lincoln Center, which was always a dream of mine to be able to perform on that stage. And I did. I have really fond memories of saying goodbye to a part of my life that I had done since I was like 10, which is, you know, classical ballet, and saying hello to this new sort of field and art that I wanted to explore. And it was all in this movie. So it was a very special movie for me. I'm still a big fan of the ballet. My family and I are. And it's something that we want our sons to sort of be surrounded by. If you can't dance, just watch others dance. I think it's really beautiful.
My bridal Barbie.
She was my wish.
What'd you wish for?
A keychain?
No, the world. That I was gonna get out of this crappy town. Go all the way to California. Put my feet in the Pacific Ocean.
There's a wish that's not coming true for a while.
We were surrounded by women from Shonda Rhimes to Tamra Davis. And then, you know, Brittany, Taryn, and I, it was exciting, it was nerve-wracking because there was just so much attention on it. It was the first time that Brittany was doing a movie, and everybody knows how special Brittany was at that time and still is. It was fun. It was just a fun experience. I didn't know the magnitude of what this was going to sort of like represent in my career because, you know, I would listen to her music, but I didn't understand just the level of impact that she had on people. And that was like my first time that I just saw how a public figure can really hold court and you know, impact people. And that was really amazing.
Thank you.
Captain Sparrow. The Black Pearl is yours.
It was my first exposure to a major Hollywood, like mega movie where there was just so many actors and so many producers and so many crew members, and we were shooting in different locations and the environments were not that agreeable sometimes to our shoot days. And I was very young, and it was just a little too big for me, and the pace of it was a little too fast, and I walked away not really having a good experience from it overall. I felt like I was lost in the trenches of it a great deal, and I just didn't feel like that was okay. But I appreciated that years later I was able to meet with Jerry Bruckheimer, who actually apologized that I had that experience, because he really wants everyone to have a good experience on his projects, and that really moved me. The fact that he remembered that I had mentioned that during a press I guess, engagement I had done years before, and that he felt compelled to bring it up and to, you know, take accountability. I just felt, it just to feel seen and heard, even as an artist throughout the years, or just as a person, it just means so much when that happened. I get to grow with the cast, like age with the cast, and throughout the years, we get to witness each other's lives in different stages, and that's beautiful. And sometimes these stages are not as fortunate, and we get to go through that together. The fact that I get to relive an experience all over again with people by coming back to these installments, it makes me feel very fortunate. If only I had that kind of luck when I played the lotto, right? If every time I choose a movie or I'm chosen for a movie, it does this good, I'm like, damn, why can't that luck be also when I play, you know, Moneyball or something? I feel lucky. I feel like sometimes like the luckiest girl alive when it comes to these franchises.
Lieutenant, I would prefer to discuss this in private.
You prefer not to discuss this at all. That's what you prefer.
Are you really going to do this right now?
What never seems to require your undivided focus, I'm sorry, Captain, just 2 seconds, okay. Is us. At that volcano, you didn't give a thought to us. What it would do to me if you died, Spock. You didn't feel anything. You didn't care. And I'm not the only one who's upset with you. The captain is too.
Well, no. Don't drag me into this. She is right.
I don't think that when you're that young and you're experiencing something for the first time, you understand the challenges that you have. You are just so happy to be there. You feel fearless and you feel like you know more than everybody in the room. Like, you're so cocky. And I feel like sometimes that innocence and that ignorance is blissful. I was not a fan of the show. I knew my mom had watched it and she was the one that reminded me to just handle it with a little grace and respect, because this was a show that had, you know, lasted the test of time because it was very special. And that made me curious. And I guess I was just asking a lot of questions, but I really felt like I was like, oh, I got this. But meeting Nichelle was groundbreaking for me, even as she was, you know, answering my questions and I had her in front of me. I remember thinking, this is a monumental thing. And I'm meeting an icon, and she was just so swift and so smooth and just so confident. And I will never forget that. I remember thinking, I can be like Nichelle, you know?
Wilhelm!
You're like a baby. My soul today.
I need your help.
You should not be here.
Okay, take me with you.
No! Go back.
I think that if I would have had that kind of like thought process, I would be like, you know, owning a huge Fortune 500 company. Like, do you understand? Like, this is like big if you can tap into these notions early on. No, I follow my heart. I go where I'm accepted, where I'm seen and I am heard. I lean into those spaces. I lean into those people and I believe them. So if they say that they like what I'm doing, I believe them. If they say that I'm doing a good job, I believe them, you know, and I give them more. And I feel that if there's anything that resonates with what I've done, is that I gravitate towards environments that are welcoming, that are good, inherently good. And I guess I follow my heart more than I, I'm not strategic. I'm not ambitious in that sense when it comes to my career. I was always just so happy and lucky to be there, you know? And now that I'm here, let me give it my all, 110%. I do dedicate a lot of work. I do the research. I do the training. I'm first one in, last one out. But heart first, first and only sometimes. I mean, to wish that Avatar 2 does as great as Avatar 1 is just arrogant. You know, like, you just want it to be special. You want to have a wonderful experience because you had a wonderful experience in the first one. In addition to, like, an open heart, there was just a lot of fear. You know, like, I bit the apple, I had babies. So now I came into this experience as an adult, a late-blooming adult with children. So, and my character was also a parent, So I had nothing but a great deal of compassion and empathy for what Neytiri was going through, and I couldn't separate. I was an early mom, you know, like I had a baby, like I had two 2-year-olds, and I had an 8-month-old, and I was just so afraid of like what could have, should have, would have happened if anything would have gone this other way. So I was a nervous wreck shooting the second one.
What happened?
This guy just backed out of a deal on me. There's one thing I hate, it's a man without integrity. Peter Quill, people call me Star-Lord.
You have the bearing of a man, Wilner.
Well, I wouldn't say that.
It was bittersweet because we've been told that this is the last of the Guardians of the Galaxy sort of installments. And I know that Gamora, you know, has taken a different journey. So whether they continue, I don't know what's in it for Gamora. In terms of like, you know, will she be a guardian again or not? So it was bittersweet. It started bitter in the beginning because obviously you're anticipating the end, but we ended on such a sweet note. And I'm just so happy that I once again got to work with great people. I had an evolution that I witnessed myself, but also of my director and my cast. I just felt very blessed and grateful. And it was a very sweet departure, I have to say.
I don't know how you're gonna get it through all that.
Don't worry.
She's got help.
Obviously, we knew it was gonna be special and we like were feeling ourselves every time the Russos would say action. But what I can remember, and these are the nuggets of life that make me feel so human and keep me grounded, is that we were just complaining about our how uncomfortable our costumes were, our makeup, our wigs, how cold the set was. But so we were just being girls, you know, going together, acting tough. And that to me was also very special.
I think that we can do this together.
What's going on?
This ain't a burden you gotta carry by yourself, son.
You know you've got us, all of us.
Italians love a good love story, and ours is for the ages.
It's a special story. We don't really dive into the complexities of grief, and especially from the perspective of the caretaker that is left behind. That's the reason why I wanted to be a part of the project. I was a child when I lost a parent, so I remember grief from a child's, you know, eye view. And this time I was going to be able to experience it in the shoes of what my mother must have gone through, losing a partner. Grief is a process that sometimes we want to cheat our way through it because we just don't want to live in it and experience that pain because it is unbearable and unimaginable. But I think that there's a lot that we're going to learn from this show and through Tembi's experience. And we kind of lend ourselves to be these vessels for Tembi and her family and the telling of her story in hopes of her family gaining some closure and also helping her give this gift to all of us, which is by sharing her story, we get to have an idea of what this can be like, because the one thing that we know is inevitable is death, you know, but at what point in our lives death comes and knocks at our doors, we can't know that. But having versions of grief that others have gone through and experienced sometimes can help us understand it for when, unfortunately, we have to go through it ourselves. And it's also like wonderful to see an American woman once again travel the world and go where she's, you know, jump into the unknown and have her eat, pray, love. And that to me was also very tempting and fun.